voters for many, many election seasons now, and sometimes even in the off season, there has been one constant debate. Will Priyanka Gandhi enter politics? Should Priyanka Gandhi enter politics? Why won't Priyanka Gandhi save the Congress by entering politics? In fact, many of us have literally grown old listening to speculations of when and how. Finally, today, months before the general elections this year, the announcement has come. In fact, if you remember, just before the UP elections 2 years ago, it appeared as if key strategist Prashant Kishore had even managed to convince the party that now was the time for Priyanka Gandhi to step up. But it didn't happen then, the inevitable has happened now. That apart, take a look at the current scenario, viewers, because today the BJP is harping about how Congress is only about one family and dynasty politics. But here is the current scenario. All around us in the polity, the current political class, Rahul Gandhi and Priyanka Gandhi, Sachin Pilot, Jyotiraditya Sindhya, many more in the Congress party, Tejasvi and Tej Pratap Yadav of the RJD, Akhilesh Yadav, and well, his entire larger clan of cousins and wives and sisters of the Samajwadi party taking charge there. Kumaraswamy, the Chief Minister of Karnataka right now, Stalin, the heir of DMK, Supriya Sule, KTR and K Kavita, Pankaja Munde, Poonam Mahajan, and many, many more. That list will begin to pop up on your screen, and we'll run those names constantly because I am trying to make this point that dynasty politics isn't just Congress's forte. So this may be one of those lists where Congress is actually on the top. But is it inseparable from politics in our country? Isn't every single party guilty of it? And does it really matter to you, the voter? So tonight, as everybody sits and debates of whether or not Priyanka Gandhi is the answer to all of Congress's problems and why this reinstates, or whether or not this reinstates the entire dynasty politics charge, let's try and understand how dynasts are still thriving in our political class today, cutting across party lines. That is going to be the big debate. But before we go across to our guests, we have a special guest joining us this evening. Senior Congress leader and former minister, Mr. Virappa Moily, is joining us here on The Last Word. Mr. Moily, thank you for speaking to the viewers of Mirror Now. My first question to you, I wonder, after years of deliberation and discussion and speculation, why has this big decision been taken now, just 3 months before elections?
No, every strategy will have its own timing, and this is the most appropriate time. And that, you know, the Priyanka ji has been named as one of the general secretary to be in charge of UP East. It's a right decision, appropriate decision. This has definitely increased the energy level of the Congress party to manifold levels. No sooner the BSP and the SP, they joined together, and they decided to share the seats among themselves, except a only unreasonable number of seats to Congress party, then they hesitated to join in partnership with the Congress. At that time, you may kindly recall that, the Congress party, of course, with the consent of our leader Rahul Gandhi, they announced that, we will contest all the 80 seats. People thought it is a hollow statement, but there was a big strategy involved in that. And now the strategy is out, and Priyanka ji is now there in the active field to ensure that, the glory of UP, and the glory of Congress, which was always, wedded together. And till about 1.5 or 2 decades back, will come back again. This will herald the entry of the Congress party, not only in a big way in UP, and exit of the BJP from UP.
So by itself, Eastern Uttar Pradesh is a big in a tall ask, considering it's a stronghold of the BJP. But Mr. Moily, do you see Priyanka Gandhi's role limited to Eastern Uttar Pradesh this election?
We always expect, because she has a potential, she has the potentiality of growing, pan-India role. She can definitely play. This has not only electrified the Congress party, also electrified the entire nation, particularly the youth of the country.
But will we see her contest this time, maybe from Sonia Gandhi's constituency, or will this largely be an organizational role?
You know, the strategy of a Congress party, you know, and our leader, you know, will be spelt out, you know, from time to time. Now, for the present, she will galvanize the party, you know, put a lot of energy into the youth of this country and also the youth of UP. I think this will herald a new era in the Congress party and also in the politics of the country.
Mr. Boyle, BJP today through the day has only said one big thing, which is that this only proves that Congress is only about one family, that this is about dynastic politics, and Congress will never change that. What would you say to that charge? Because obviously after Rahul Gandhi, you have brought on Priyanka now.
You know, the BJP is obsessed with the family of Nehru and obsessed with the Indian National Congress. Of course, they name... Yeah, here, you know, the saying that family, dynasty and all, it's all false, because they get inspiration from the country and the people of the country, all cross-section of the people. And equally, the country gets inspiration from the Gandhi family, and there is no doubt about it. You cannot just brush aside saying this is a dynastic rule or perpetuation of the dynastic rule. There is no such thing. You know, 135 years of the Congress party has seen all spectrum of leaders, biggest leaders. It's not confined to only one family. Just because this family is, of course, the people love them, and there's a warm feeling that, you know, they always, you know, they connect to the people of this country, connect to the Indian soil. This is why, you know, BJP is always afraid, because, you know, they have been of a recent origin, and, you know, they don't have that kind of a big legacy or the past. But the Congress has the past legacy of 135 years, cutting across all spectrum of people. The greatest leaders of the country, you know, you name anything, you know, who sacrificed their lives, who sacrificed their youth, and they hail only from the Congress party and not from the BJP. BJP has no legacy of freedom fighting, freedom movement, or no legacy of any development which has taken place in the post-independence era.
But let's also look at the legacy within the Congress party, Mr. Moily. You have Sachin Pilot, you have Jyotiraditya Scindia, you have Rahul and Priyanka Gandhi. They're all dynasts. They all also may be Gen Next and new generation of leaders. Is that a deliberate move?
No, it's a conscious and deliberate move. And, you know, for the next generation, you know, the country being the youngest, you know, for another 30 years, you know, we need to look forward for these young leaders of this type. Next generation leadership can be thrown only by the Congress party, whether it was during the freedom fight or later or now. And I think this will totally refurbish the politics of this country, and people, the young people in this country, they look forward to that. If you want to take advantage of the population dividend, you know, the demographic dividend, I think the Congress alone can, you know, respond to that kind of a call of the nation to optimize the demographic dividend. And this is today's decision is demonstration of that fact and reality.
Mr. Veerappa Moily, thank you so much. I appreciate you taking the time out to speak to us and to our viewers. Thank you so much for joining us. Let's straight go to our guests now and begin the debate and open it up, not just for our panelists, but also for our viewers. Let's hear from you. The big question that we are asking today is dynasty politics, dynasty and politics, is that an inseparable jodi in our country? Anila Singh, spokesperson for the BJP, Vinod Sharma, political editor with Hindustan Times, Sangeet Kumar Ragi, political analyst. I've also got Aishwarya Mahadev of the Congress party joining me this evening, and Juhi Singh of the Samajwadi party also with us. Let me start with Mr. Vinod Sharma and ask him this question. Mr. Sharma, is it an inseparable jodi? More and more of the Gen X within politics are all, you know, sons and daughters or nephews of some big neta.
Well, of course, it is avoidable, but we don't live in an ideal world. Democracies have been plagued, so to speak, by dynasties across the world. Start from the United States, you had the Kennedy dynasty, you had the Bush dynasty. Closer in the neighborhood, you have the Bhutto dynasty. Now you have a Nawaz Sharif dynasty. Then you had in Bangladesh, the Sheikh Hasina dynasty. We don't tire of from celebrating. We also have the Koirala dynasty in Sri Lanka. So these are democratic dynasties. These are not North Korean dynasties. They are not autocratic dynasties. They come, they revise their mandate. They come to us every 5 years. And if we are unhappy with them, we can throw them out.
Mm.
So I think this whole dynasty debate has a political motive behind it. And that is part of democracy. One cannot hold it against the BJP that they keep on raising this issue. But when they raise this issue, they should also remember that they have also some use for the Nehru-Gandhi dynasty, because they have Varun Gandhi in their ranks. He's a sitting MP of the BJP. And also, they have Manaka Gandhi. What's her claim to fame? That she got married into the Gandhi Nehru family. Now, coming to Priyanka Gandhi, she started a political campaign, started her stint in political campaigning by defeating a Nehru, by having a role in the defeat of a Nehru, which happened to be Arun Nehru, another dynast who took a detour to BJP via the VP Singh's Janamorcha and then later his government. So what are we talking about, you know? If we raise a finger, point a finger at one person, we have three pointing at ourselves. So I don't want to get into this debate at all. I personally feel that so long as the dynasties are democratic, they revive their mandate every 5 years, you can't really avoid them. Within the BJP, you have dynasties. Is Mulayam Singh not a dynasty? Is Akhilesh not a dynasty? Is in some way Mayawati not a dynasty? In the sense that she has taken over the legacy of Kanshiram. Can we talk about, for instance, the Akali Dal, the most profligate dynasty? You have DMK, which is another dynasty.
Yes, absolutely.
You had Jayalalitha, which is an improvisation of dynasty. So I think it's a waste of time discussing dynasty. So long as the people are electing them, we can't be cribbing. And if Varun Gandhi gets elected on BJP, so be it.
Okay, let me take Priyanka that point Gandhi across, Mr. Sharma, to Sangeet Kumar Raghi, who's been listening to you and has a and is an amused look on his face. Mr. Raghi, that is the point. It's not just the Congress party, and if the people at the end of the day have to make a choice and they vote these people back to power, then is that a problem?
Absolutely not. But certainly my head hangs in shame when I feel and when I hear this kind of narratives from the political and intellectual class of this country, who sing the rhyme of medieval century, medieval era, when the you know, the court poets used to sing in favor of the monarchs. Priyanka Gandhi or the Gandhi family, the democracy of this country has matured and has moved beyond that. I think that the Priyanka Gandhi or the Gandhi family, you know, the Congress is, you know, may feel charm about it, Gandhi family, but, you know, the electorates have shown that they have been beaten again and again in the electoral battle. And, you know, the democracy has matured so much so that the people, common man, really question that what kind of democracy we are living in. We are a very inexperienced person, inexperienced person, just because he happens to be the, you know, the son of the prime minister, wants to be the prime minister. The son of the minister is a minister, and the common voter is just a, you know, common voter. In the, what kind of new caste democracy that we are living in? Second thing, you know, the democracy, second point that I wish to make, that every time, such things come, the Congress party always use that, the family has sacrificed. The family has sacrificed. I want to put it the other way also. That nation has also sacrificed many more things because of the family. That aspect also needs to be reevaluated. And entire historiography needs to be rewritten. And I'm talking about the political historiography of the Congress Party. Hmm. Why don't we talk about 1962? Why India lost one third of Kashmir too? So I think that these narratives, I am putting it in a different way. I think that, third point that I wish to make, I think that it will, Vinod Sharma, whom I respect a lot, would love that the patriarchy actually exists within the Congress Party, and more importantly, in the Congress Party. Because today, I found many spokesperson talking about that now the entire half of the population, the women population, is going to vote for the Congress Party because she also epitomized she becomes the icon of the Indian woman. That is not. I think that for the Darbari Bhakts, that may be a case, but for a common citizen, it doesn't matter at all.
Okay.
That Congress Party, the dynast Rahul Gandhi has appointed his sister as the General Secretary. Now it is more important to think about that, is Congress Party going along the line of, the Samajwadi Party led by Akhilesh Yadav, Or Lalu Yadav, where every member of the family is either legislature, in legislative assembly or in the parliament or holding certain position, or Ram Vilas Paswan, where from, all the uncles and aunts are occupying the position. I think that this is the degradation of the Congress Party.
By the examples that you have cited, you've also again validated the fact that I was making, and also the point that Mr. Vinod Sharma was making, that it exists, and it exists across party lines. And you may not want to name some of the BJP dynasts who are currently in the Lok Sabha or within the party. You have Rajnath Singh's son, who is the General Secretary of BJP Uttar Pradesh. And I read out some of the other names. Ashwarya, I would want to read some more names. Of the fact of the matter is that it exists across party lines. Now, if it does exist, why is it so? Is it inseparable because we refuse to move on? That's the question that I'm seeking an answer to right now. So, if you have a specific response to that, before I go across to our political representatives.
I think that we need to make a distinction between the dynasty within a dynasty that exists and work within the Congress Party and the dynasty that works in the BJP, because here is the one where the top position is always the prime ministerial position, the Congress president position is always fixed for the one family. Or the same is the case with Akhilesh Yadav. You can't find this kind of fixation of the position in case of the BJP.
Okay.
You won't find that.
All
yes.
Right. Okay. Chief, so point taken
Rajnath
there.
Rajnath Singh happened to be the chief minister. He will be going to be the chief minister of the BJP in Uttar Pradesh.
Okay. Okay. Point taken. So what you are saying right now is that because the BJP presidents
at the center.
Point taken, Mr. Raghi. You are saying BJP presidents are not all from the same party, whereas all Congress presidents are from the same party. I got your point. Let me take that across to Ashwarya Mahadev and then to Juhi Singh. Ashwarya Mahadev, so the differentiation is that, BJP presidents are being democratically elected. They don't belong to one party, unlike the Congress or even the Samajwadi.
I think it's absolutely pathetic that a person claiming to be some sort of expert in any domain comes up here and paints only half the picture. So Tanvi, let me give you a few statistics before I rattle off a bunch of names, right, about dynasts. First and foremost, 44% of all MLAs in the Lok Sabha are dynasts, and they all come from the BJP. Second, let me, I did not interrupt you. Do not interrupt me, sir.
Yes, okay. No, but I will agree with Sangeet Kumar Ragi here. Ashwarya, let's not make any personal comments about any of the panelists on this show, please.
Rhymes of Darbaris.
Your objection. I agree with Sangeet Kumar Ragi, and I'm making it clear. No personal comments about any of the panelists, please. Let's stick to the subject.
Let me finish. Yes, stop talking, please, sir. Can I complete?
Yes, I won't tolerate any kind of
nonsense.
Tanvi,
first and foremost, 44% BJP dynasties. One out of, oh my God, sir, can you please be courteous for me to finish talking? And then you may say everything you want, however fallacious it is. Second statistics, one out of every five of the BJP ministers in the central government are dynasties. Right? And so you're talking about one Gandhi Parivar. There are a whole bunch of them, a lot of them, right? Whether it's Sushma Swaraj's husband, whether it's Nirmala Sitharaman's husband, whether it's the fact that Rajnath Singh's son is an MLA, Piyush Goyal, Bhupendra Chaudhary, a whole bunch of them. An entire list of people are dynasts. I'll tell you one thing, Tanvi, and this is the fundamental problem I have, is that every time the Congress does something, it's an absolute sin. But when the BJP does it, it has some sort of sacred sanction. The simple fact of the matter is, in a democracy, democracy and to be elected and to be in politics is every single person's birthright. Whether you're a dynast or whether you're a grassroots worker or a first generation person in politics. Yes, I will concede that if you are born into a dynasty, you do get a leg up. But in today's day and age, the situation is very simple. The competitive sphere and also electorate is far more aware that they believe if you are not deserving, and I believe the first speaker also, and sir, said it very succinctly, is that at some point you still go back to the democracy and the electorate to put you back in power. We have seen several children of very top leaders having not made a mark because the electorate just did not accept them. The simple argument is this: whether dynasty exists or not is immaterial to the fact that politics should be for dynasts as well as other people. And even if they get a leg up, the system will weed out anybody who's not capable.
But right? I'm not too sure if the system
Priyanka Gandhi Vadra wants to come into politics, that is her right.
Okay, I'm not too sure though that about this system and whether it works in a foolproof manner, because if you're not giving options and if you're not giving opportunities to non-dynasts, to common people, to people who genuinely may want to be part of politics and change or serve this country, then how is that going to happen? If my limited options, 1 minute, please let me, I heard you out. If my limited options are between the son of a neta and a daughter of a neta, or the wife of a neta and a nephew of a neta, or a niece of a neta, or the uncle of a neta, if those are my limited options, then that's that. Now, Juhi Singh, your entire party is full of that. You know, there were so many candidates in the assembly elections that happened a couple of years ago. All distant cousins, wives, sisters, husbands, uncles fighting amongst each other. How does it work? Is your voter all right with this? Do you even give them any other option apart from the big Yadav clan?
Tanvi, humble submission, there were many of us who are not dynasts, who don't belong to any political parties, who were given tickets, who have worked in the organization. To say that the Samajwadi Party distributed tickets only to uncles and cousins, I would say that it is falsified information out here. Having said that, yes, belonging to a political party does give you entry, makes it easier. But after that, your accountability and your responsibility is really on your shoulders. The BJP gave ticket to Hukum Singh's daughter in Kairana. She lost. He was their star campaigner and a tall leader. Our MP from Kannauj, Dimple Yadavji, also lost her first election. So it's not always that you win an election. And I would say that a majority of the tickets from most parties are given to non-dynasts. The argument from the BJP may come in that the president can belong only to a family. That is also not true. We elect our own president. Every party has a democratic structure, and the BJP may also clarify, because they are the ones who's raising this voice. And Sangeet Ragi, the impartial observer, is also saying that how many elections have taken place in the BJP for the national president, or does the message just come from somewhere? So yes, we are all looking at the same scenario. It's a democratic polity and it's a mature polity, Tanvi. So I would say that the voters, anybody's voters, there are no voters which are bound to a particular party. In 2012, the Samajwadi Party, traditionally not an urban party, swept the cities, including Lucknow. And then we lost also. And as for making ministers, then again I would state the BJP, Mr. Lalji Tandon, the governor somewhere, his son, the minister, cabinet minister, what is his experience? Maybe, you know, and the grandsons are also being given tickets. tickets. So yes, don't point fingers at another party, but there is space and your ability does come through. There are many of us who would vouch for it in most parties. So I would say that there is no macro level observation for me to make, and no particular party whom you can say that we are distributing tickets only on the basis of the family. Yes, Tanvi.
Okay, I'm reading out from a print article which says that in BJP, 38 of its 281 Lok Sabha MPs and 9 of its 56 Rajya Sabha MPs have a strong political lineage, that fathers of 8 of these 38 dynasts, they would be also called, were chief ministers or deputy chief ministers, including sons of Raman Singh, Vasundhara Raje, Rajveer Singh, who is the son of former UP chief minister Kalyan Singh. 12 of the 71 BJP MPs on the state have a political lineage. Bihar is second, in fact, with 5 of the 22. Also in Maharashtra, with 4 out of the 23 BJP MPs qualify for the dynast tags. It's a quite detailed article, actually, and there are detailed similar analysis for Congress Party, for DMK, Samajwadi Party, even for TRS, and every other major party that you would want to think of. So Anila Singh, really, does the BJP have any moral standing right now to cry foul about dynasty politics and only point fingers at Congress?
Tanvi, we must understand one thing. When we talk about dynocracy is when one particular family has absolute control on that particular political party. So we are not discussing here that different members of that political parties make their family members, whether son, nieces, uncles or whatever, contest election and then making them ministers and all. It's okay. It is happening pan world. But when one particular family has absolute control on the political party and that family decides that who is going to be the president, who is going to be the ministers, who is going to contest the election, who is going to be the in charge of Uttar Pradesh,
right.
West Uttar Pradesh or East Uttar Pradesh, then that is dynocracy. So, it is very natural. Like today, I'm in politics. Tomorrow, my son might come into it. It is not wrong. It is not unhealthy. But yes, our country is a democratic country and we got our independence in 1947. But unfortunately, Congress carried on this legacy of dynocracy. I mean, the slavery mentality of the Congressees that percolated in different political parties also. All those political parties majorly which offshooted from the Congress. So, dynocracy is this. And in today's date, when Priyanka Gandhi ji has entered into politics openly now, and she has been given charge of East Uttar Pradesh, I welcome it. I welcome it because even I am a woman, and more women in politics is a good thing. It's a good thing, absolutely good thing. But again, see, they have divided Uttar Pradesh in two parts. East Uttar Pradesh goes to Priyanka Gandhi.
Small,
again, she is coming from a very caste family. And West Uttar Pradesh goes to Jyotiraditya Scindia. Mm. Again, he is coming from the royal families. Mm. So this proves that Congress definitely vouches for the people coming from very, very important family background. It is not the political party which chooses people from armed family, common family. So this is the difference in between other political parties and the Congress.
Ashwarya Mahadev.
I think it's ridiculous to basically paint everybody with the same brush. For every two dynasts that you have, you see young people like me being given an opportunity in a national political party and being given the recognition on the ground and also by the leadership. And I think if you talk about, oh no, all the Congress prime ministers, all the Congress presidents, please tell me, ma'am, go back and recall in history how many of the AICC, the Congress committee presidents, have been from the Gandhi family and how many of them have not. Also, if it was so much of us dynasty motivated, why was Mrs. Sonia Gandhi not not the Prime Minister for the two terms that she could have been. And I think it is extremely, extremely unfair that when you paint somebody with the brush of a dynast, irrespective of what capability they have, you'd like to attribute everything to saying, oh no, it is because of family. And I don't believe that is always the case. I understand opportunities for people coming in first generation politics may be hard, but that situation is changing. For example, so in my own party,
you will admit
our entire youth congress set up, both of them are grassroots work.
Yes, so you will admit right now, of course, that Priyanka is getting it for her privilege and that because she is a Gandhi, that she's been made the General Secretary of Eastern Uttar Pradesh. You will admit right now she's not proven anything. We don't know what her political standings are. We don't know what her political experience and capabilities are.
No, she's been given this charge. Tanvi.
Yes, all she has done so far is campaign for her brother and mother.
Okay. Very simply put, this is the biggest problem that I found today, is that just because somebody doesn't embellish and put out everything that they've done does not mean that they do not work. Everybody in the Congress ecosystem knows a few things. First and foremost, she has had on-ground experience from the 1990s when she has campaigned for her family members. Second of all, Raibari and Amethi, yes, but in the previous Uttar Pradesh elections, she was on the ground campaigning in a lot of constituencies. When it comes down to the organization, she is one of the most silent workers, but is an immense strength to all the fronters and also the AICC, and it's essential to organization and also coordinating and working with leaders. Do not judge somebody just because they do not plaster pictures of the work that they're doing everywhere. And Tanvi, very honestly, everybody in the Congress knows her contribution, which is why we're applauding the fact that she's entered active politics, because she's always taken a back seat. Everybody, Mrs. Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi ji, have always said she will enter politics when she feels the time is right. Mm. And I think because she's worked in that state before, what we're giving her is absolutely capable, and now she has to prove it. It's not like because you're a dynast, you were given a prime ministerial post or a cabinet berth. You made Rahul Gandhi
the president of your party before he could prove anything. Frankly, the victories of states, even if you want to attribute them to Rahul Gandhi, only came much later. He became the president much before he could actually prove his mettle for anything. And what did Congress party achieve when he was a vice president for you to justify his promotion?
Pathetic. Okay. You do realize when he was vice president, yes, first we took responsibility for the loss that happened, but the sort of build up on the ground when it comes to frontals, and also look at the strength of the IYC today and also the NSUI and the sort of leadership that it has provided to the main PCCs all across the country. And he did work critically. And again, because you don't have the documented sort of PR embellished and like, you know, the glossy pictures everywhere, doesn't mean work wasn't done, ma'am. And I believe after that, he has time and time again proven, and irrespective even of his precedent, on the same metric, when everybody says he got it easy, do you think when we went through loss after loss after loss, it was easy for Mr. Rahul Gandhi to digest? Because everybody put the picture of he's a dynast who has failed. But nobody will say this is a success story after we won three big states, after we unseated the the BJP in three states.
Yes.
And I think very simply,
Ms. Mahadev,
it has to
you're
be the
actually...
merit and the metric of your work, which is going to be measured. And I believe Mrs. Priyanka...
You are actually saying exactly what I said, that he had to deal and take responsibility of defeat after defeat after defeat. Now, are you telling me if it was a non-Gandhi, he would have continued to be given all these chances? You said right now that if Priyanka Gandhi doesn't deliver on Eastern Uttar Pradesh, she may not get another opportunity. Just think about it. That's exactly what even I was saying. Anila Singh wanted to come in between, and then I have a question for Mr. Vinod Sharma. But Anila Singh, yes, what did you want to say?
Tanvi, when you were firing questions on Aishwarya, I mean, her reaction was pathetic. I mean, she reacted by saying pathetic. Like, I can very well understand that Congress today might be very, very happy because Priyanka Gandhi has come into politics formally. But at the same time, they know very well that the leadership of Rahul has failed. It has flopped, and it is not being accepted by the allied partners, but in the Congress itself as well. Because we very well know when Rahul Gandhi had showed his wish to become the Prime Minister of the country, how the senior leaders of the Congress, they came in front and they said, nahi, Rahul Gandhi abhi Pradhan Mantri ka candidate nahi ho sakte hain. So these were the statements given by the Congress. And I was hearing to Mr. Mollier as well in the beginning of your show, and very categorically, like, he was really vouching for Priyanka Gandhi, and he did not say a single word about Rahul Rahul Gandhi, and he said that Congress is electrified, and she is going to galvanize the Congress, and the youth is really going to become very energetic, not only in Uttar Pradesh but in India. So what Rahul Gandhi ji is doing, if Priyanka Gandhi has to galvanize, energize and electrify.
Okay. Yeah, actually, you've come to the point, so that I wanted to...
I can very well see the future. Okay. Now you've come... fight is in between brother and sister.
Okay, you've raised a point that any which has wanted to talk about. And I, in fact, have a few viewers who've also messaged saying, what is the logic? How is Priyanka Gandhi going to change anything? Mr. Vinod Sharma, for all of those times and conversations that have happened about bringing her in, now to do it maybe 10 years or 12 years, 15 years since those conversations. And Sangeet Kumar Ragi, I'll come to you next on that. What is the logic? Why will this work? What is it that Priyanka can do that Rahul couldn't?
Well, I will have to have a sense of clairvoyance to answer that question. The Congress party obviously has acted on the basis of some information, some input that they had. I was on the other channel just now, where Prashant Kishore was interviewed briefly, and he said that when he was in charge of the UP elections for the Congress and Samajwadi, he wanted Priyanka to go the whole hog because he thought that there was a groundswell of support for Priyanka Gandhi in Uttar Pradesh. Now, this is not me saying, this is Prashant Kishore saying, who continues to be the vice president of Janata Dal United. Now, leave that aside. Leave the utility of Priyanka Gandhi aside. You see, you know, I don't like the flow of this discussion because this has become a discussion on dynasties, you know.
Yes.
And dynasties are reality of life. Now, frankly, look at the track record of other dynasts. Benazir Bhutto became a prime minister, got prominence, but she, when she died, she left a legacy of her own. Indira Gandhi left a legacy of her own. Chandrika Kumaratunga has a legacy of her own. Sheikh Hasina has a legacy of her own. Is that legacy inherited? No. They've earned it. So let us not deride dynasties. Yes, of course, we must, as true Democrats, always ask for equal opportunity for other people who want to join politics. We have to do that consistently. And from the BJP standpoint, the Gandhi-Nehru dynasty is at their... they target it because they know ki once the Gandhi-Nehru family goes out of the Congress equation, the Congress will fall apart. Mm. They are the pivot around which the Congress wheel moves. It's unfortunate, but it's a fact. And we saw the Sitaram Kesari tenure where the Congress was falling apart. It was a pathetic version of what the Congress used to be once upon a time. Not that it is much healthier now. But in relative terms, it's better. It's better off. And it was restored to power for 10 years. So when political parties always talk about winnability, and citing winnability, they give tickets to criminals and to people with doubtful antecedents. If a political party, and not this is not just the Congress, they are relying on dynasts or on families that have a connect with people. Now, why did Mr. Advani, for instance, once said that it's always good to present a face? Because in this country where education is not evenly spread, people relate faces with thoughts and ideologies.
Right.
It helps political parties. This is the dynamics of real politics. So let us not just reject one concept to promote a concept which may sound very laudatory, but is hugely impractical. For instance, when Mr. Narendra Modi got presented prime ministerial candidate, wasn't there dissent within the BJP, and that dissent emanated from the top.
Yes.
So let us not, please, for God's sake, I think no political party, Congress included, BJP included, has any moral standing to be questioning each other on projecting dynasts, except for the left parties.
Yes.
Where there are regular elections. Tell me which political party, when was last election held for the presidency of BJP?
When was last election held for presidency of the Congress except for Jitin Prasad when he contested against Sonia Gandhi? So, you see, they decide on a candidate and he gets endorsed by the national executives.
Okay.
That is the procedure.
Let me bring in
to
Mr. Say, Raghi.
To try and acquire a moral high, I think it's fallacious. I mean, it doesn't gel.
So, Mr. Raghi, of course, you can respond to what Vinod Sharma is saying, but also respond to my question. Why will Priyanka Gandhi work? Why does the Congress Party think so? Why did Prashant Kishore think so? Do you think so? Yes, Sangeet Kumar Raghi, that question to you as you also respond to what Vinod Sharma said.
Okay, okay. So, sorry, I was not getting the communication. Okay. I'm really shocked to hear this narrative. In fact, it is not now a dynasty. You know, we are not talking about dynasty politics. Actually, the parties are turning into family parties. That is the problem. All the regional political formations today, we find most of the regional political formations who are trying to, you know, collaborate with the Congress parties are basically the family party, be it Akhilesh Yadav party, be it, Stalin party there. You will be finding that, as Anula Singh said, it's not that your children are into politics. That is fine, because they are after all in the field of the politics. Here the problem is that one family is actually controlling the entire, you know, political party, and that is the political, that family is actually deciding every position in the party. Hmm. Here you find that the mama, sister and brother party. Hmm. And that, you know, what kind of democracy is this? And we should, you know, if venability is the criterion, let us not also criticize why criminals are into it. I think that another question I am putting, and I am throwing for, you know, discussion, that are there no good women party workers, you know, who could be elevated to this position which Priyanka Gandhi is occupying today? What Priyanka Gandhi has done to the UP politics in last 5 years? Tell me, there are so many, I know so many Congress leaders. You know, one can be, you know, cheerleaders. You know, you know that in the Weberian form,
right,
that it is a patrimonial bureaucracy.
Okay.
And in the patrimonial form of organization, you find that the cheerleaders are around, they are loyal to, and they are going to sing this kind of rhyme. So I'm not worried about that, and I don't find that it is objective analysis of Priyanka Gandhi entering into politics.
Okay, okay. Quickly going across to one of our viewers on the phone line, he's been patiently waiting, by Vishwajit Thakur on the phone line from Kolkata. Vishwajit Thakur, what's your view?
Yeah, good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
Ma'am, ये issue जो आपने रखा है इतना बड़ा issue है, इसमें मैं बहुत short में एक मिनट में समझ लूँगा आपका. मैं ये कहना चाहता हूँ कि हम लोग डायनेस्टी से अपने आप को अलग कर लिए थे 1947 15 अगस्त को, लेकिन आज फिर से हम एक नए डायनेस्टी को देख रहे हैं जो हमारा अपना देसी वर्जन है, ये इंडियन वर्जन है. मैम, ये 2019 है. मैं जब देखता हूँ राहुल गांधी को, अखिलेश, स्टालिन, कनी मोदी, ये तेज प्रताप, तेजस्वी, मुझे लगता है कि मैं फिर से हम डेमोक्रेसी में नहीं है. और इनको मुझे कहते हुए मैम थोड़ा सा बुरा लग रहा है, इनको मैं डेमोक्रेटिक लीडर के रूप में मैं नहीं देखता हूँ. आज का यंग जो यूथ वोटर है, जो एजुकेटेड है, जो आज जाएगा वोट करने के लिए 2019 में, वो इनको एक डेमोक्रेसी के किलर के रूप में देखता है, इनको एक असुर के रूप में देखता है जो हमारे डेमोक्रेसी को फिनिश करने में लगे हुए हैं.
विश्वजीत जी, मैं आपके जो व्यू है उससे सहमत हूँ. बहुत लोग हैं जो यही व्यू रखते हैं, पर वो भी लोग हैं जो इन्हीं लीडर्स को चुनते हैं. जब इलेक्शन होते हैं तो वही सचिन पायलट को जिताया जाता है, वही राहुल गांधी को जिताया जाता है, और वही अखिलेश को जिताया जाता है. जूही सिंह, हाउ डज दैट वर्क, यू नो, ऑन ग्राउंड व्हेन यू इंटरेक्ट विद पीपल, आर देयर क्वेश्चंस एवर आस्क्ड विद इन द पार्टी? आर देयर पीपल हु से वी डिजर्व इट मोर देन एन एक्स वाई जेड कजन ऑफ सो एंड सो अंकल?
Tanvi, our national president is a 3 times MP. People have chosen him. We have elected him as the national president. So to really turn this discourse towards why anybody doesn't approve of him is really irrelevant. And you cannot choose your definition of dynasty as per convenience of the BJP or the Congress. Of course, if your children, if you are making a way for your children to come into politics, it is a sort of a, let's say, family-oriented entry. You do get that advantage. But apart from that, it is democracy. And when the people go out, then the people would know what leader they respect and they elect. And what sort of election does the BJP have? Because they are the ones who are changing the definitions also for their national president. They may please put in the public domain. As for us, the Samajwadi Party approves and completely supports the entry of women and young people into politics. And if Priyanka Gandhi or any woman is coming into politics or given any responsibility, then everybody should be happy about it. She has to also prove herself out there on the ground. It's not easy terrain for her in Uttar Pradesh or for anyone. The regional players are very strong. And to really brand the regional parties as family parties, I mean, that's a very simplistic view, which might suit Mr. Raghi. Yes, his discourse is in accordance with that, but that's not what we believe. Why give tickets to Kalyan Singh's sons and grandsons? Why make people ministers? Why get Rajnath Singh's? What are his qualifications? What for Pankaj Munde's qualifications? The names we can rattle off, but this is a serious discussion. And yes, as I said, that it's really the last word is up to people. And they sometimes make children or relatives of the tall people also, you know, leaders from every party lose. But otherwise, yes, okay, they win elections. And
yes, you know, perhaps there is something
like a national president or our MP from Kannauj is doing. Yes,
well, you know, perhaps there is something to what Mr. Vinod Sharma was saying. And that's what it is. People view some of these faces as the family or as the ideology of a specific kind and then vote accordingly. I've run out of time, so I'm going to thank my panelists. But just to give you a sense of why we wanted to have a larger conversation beyond the Gandhis about dynasty politics, because if you look at the map of India, then starting from Jammu and Kashmir, where now 2 generations of Abdullahs have continued, to Punjab, where 2 generations of Badals, along with 3 generations of the Amar Singh clan, exist in politics. In Haryana, there have been 4 generations of Chautalas with the INLD and 2 generations of the Hoodas. Uttar Pradesh, we've just listed it out. Within Delhi, there have been 3 generations of the Dixit family of the Congress party. Within the Samajwadi party, 2 generations, but a huge, it's literally like a distant family party that's running the Samajwadi party in Uttar Pradesh. If you go down south, then you have the Karunanidhi clan, which is of 2 generations, but again, it's a huge family and they're all within, they're all part of DMK and in active politics. 2 generations of the YSR Reddys, 3 generations of the NTRs and now Naidus, 2 generations of Patnaiks in Orissa, 2 generations of Khan Chaudhuris in Bengal, 2 generations of the Pawars in Maharashtra, 2 generations of the Gowdas, 2 generations of the Deoras in Maharashtra, 3 generations of Shiv Sena, of the Thackerays and Shiv Sena, 3 generations of Sindhias across BJP and the Congress party. This is the reality of our country. Politics has become a family business. Now, it's up to us. Whether we, when we choose for these people, we choose for that, choose that individual for their promises, for their skills, for their performance, or do we do it because it's one specific family and we like that family or we like their ideology? That's for the voter to decide. Completely out of time, so thank you so much on this edition of The Last Word. Well, with that, it's a wrap on this debate. Thank you for joining us.